Everyone, welcome to this, the 20th meeting of the Welfare Reform Committee in 2014. Could everyone please make sure that their mobile phones and other electronic devices are on silent or switched to airplane mode? We have apologies today from our new member, Annabel Goldie. She's attending a medical appointment. That brings us to agenda item one, which is a decision on whether to take item three in private, because item three is a consideration of the committee's work programme. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, that's agreed. Agenda item two is our Your Say evidence session on the impact of welfare reform on mental health. I welcome our panel and thank the Scottish Association for Mental Health, which has worked with us to enable them to be here today. With us this morning, we have James Nisbet and John Lindsay. We have apologies from Peter Roberts, who unfortunately could not make it along this morning, although he had planned to be here. We've invited you both here today to share your experiences of the welfare reforms. The committee will ask you a range of questions, and we're keen to hear about any issues you have faced, how easy it was to apply or otherwise, and anything that you think could be of assistance to us in trying to improve the system. However, if at any point you feel uncomfortable or you don't wish to answer, that is absolutely fine. Simply let me know and we'll move on to other questioning. I believe each of you has prepared a written statement and agreed an order in which you'll speak. And I think, John, you were going to go first, so over to you.
Okay, good morning. My name is John Lindsay and I stay in Murrowell. I started receiving Job Seekers Allowance in September 2011. I was then sent to a job called the Shaw Trust from October 2011 to April 2012. I was put on a job placement with the paint shed in Glasgow for 4 months, but was then unable to find a job. I was then sent to the employ about 2012 and was impressed with the first two introductory sessions, as I was asked many questions about what I could do and what type of jobs would have a negative impact on my health. I felt like it was only a matter of time before I got work. However, this was not to be the case. My experience with the employ had a terrible effect on my mental health. I was with them for over a year and had four different advisers who were only interested in trying to get me work that would have a disastrous impact on my health. They bullied me into doing a security course, which I never wanted to do. They also lied to me before the interviews about the nature of the work I would be interviewed on. The final straw which pushed me over the edge was when my advisor made me apply for a security job, which involved travelling around Scotland, mainly up to Aberdeen. I knew I couldn't do this job as I was suffering from high anxiety and depression, but they forced me to apply for it anyway. Within a week, I got a phone call from the security company, and then I went for an interview, then I got the job. This happened around August, September 2013. I went up to Aberdeen to start the job, and realised that all the things I was told were lies. The accommodation was terrible, as there was mice running around the kitchen, there was rubbish everywhere, and there were around 30 men staying in this flat. That was only for starters. I walked out in the morning and headed home. My anxiety and depression rocketed after this. Not that it wasn't bad before. My thoughts in committing suicide were constant, although I thought about suicide before, but this, not all the time like this. I would cry for no reason at all, and I think I'd have sort of breakdown. During these 2 years between September 2011 and September 2013 was when my anxiety really started to increase. Every time I went to the job centre, I was talked down to like a scrounger, like I wasn't interested in finding work. They also tried to get me to apply for jobs that were not suitable, even though they knew I had a mental health condition and was on antidepressants. I had to go to the job centre every second Thursday at 11 a.m, but for a few days before I went to the job centre, I'd be a complete mess. I would start getting really anxious and depressed. The thought of suicide would be regular. 2014 was my last year at Job Seekers Allowance. Every time I went to the job centre, I kept seeing staff talking to customers in a totally disrespectful way. I also kept hearing about people getting sanctioned for silly reasons. And I was aware of the powers the DWP had to sanction people. Every time I went to the job centre, I thought I was going to get sanctioned. This made my anxiety and depression hit the roof. In September 2013, I had enough. My doctor gave me a sick note for 3 months and I applied for a ESA. In 2 weeks, I got a notification that I'd be receiving, this was a mistake, £140 every 2 weeks. And I received the dreaded ATOS form saying I was to fill this in and have it handed in within 4 weeks. I try to leave it for the first 2 weeks to try and forget about the form and get my head together. Then I get a letter from ATOS saying they haven't received my forms yet, and if they don't get them in the next 2 weeks, they will stop my money. In the third week, I went to the sixth advice to get my forms filled in. When they got round to seeing me, they said that I would have to arrange an appointment with somebody who specialises in filling these forms. They then gave me an appointment for the day the forms were supposed to be handed in, so I refused them politely and got my mum to fill in the forms for me. On the forms, they would ask questions about your past and about suicide. Answering the questions made me feel terrible and suicidal, even though my mum was filling in the forms and asking me the questions. In September, the same time as I started ESA, I was given an antidepressant called mirtazapine. This was terrible. I would sleep 18 hours a day and fall asleep in public. I was unable to function properly and had no concentration whatsoever. I couldn't honestly remember how I spent most of my day. I was like a zombie. My doctor also referred me to a psychiatrist and a CPN. The psychiatrist kept upping the dosage of mirtazapine and I got worse. The day I was put on the maximum dosage, I started to hear whispering noises in my head, laughing, and telling me to kill myself. These noises happened for 3 days until I dropped the dosage. Thankfully, I don't take this medication anymore. I stopped taking them within a few weeks after the noises. The CPN was absolutely terrible. He would come out to my house and ask me how I was getting on. Within 5 seconds, me explaining how I was getting on, he would then talk over me and keep talking at me for about 30 to 45 minutes. I was unable to tell him the reasons why I felt the way I did. He wasn't interested. He was too busy talking at me and giving me daft bits of paper and talking rubbish at what's happening in his life. I really don't understand how this man's a CPN. Luckily, at the same time, when I was seeing a CPN, I was getting peer support from Richard at Sam H. The employee advised me to apply for peer support, so I did. It was good talking and getting to know Richard because he listened to me and gave me advice and he had a good idea what was going through. It was Richard who suggested that I should think about going to college and applying for social sciences. This was the furthest thing from my head as I was unsure of how to do it. Richard kept me right and advised me. Thanks to Richard, he helped steer me in the right direction and I'll always be grateful for this. I got a phone call on my mobile in April and a lady on the phone says she is phoning to ask me to come in for my assessment in 2 weeks and it would be on a Saturday. Obviously I couldn't refuse. The appointment wasn't within the 3 months they said, it was around 7-8 months. I went to the appointment with my mum and when we got to the assessment centre, we stood outside for a few minutes as we got there early. My phone rang and I answered. It was the woman who was assessing me, asking if I was coming today, 15 minutes before the appointment. I told her we were outside. Me and my mum went in and sat around for 10 minutes waiting for the appointment time. We then got called into a room. The woman seemed friendly at first. The woman then started asking questions. I was so anxious that the answers never came out right. The kind of questions asked were all about my mental health. The questions also felt like they were trying to get me, asking me things to confuse me, to give me the wrong answers. Sometimes when she asked me certain questions and wasn't satisfied with the answers, she'd get a bit ratty. She also asked me many distressing questions on my suicidal thoughts, which I feel was a bit inappropriate, would make me feel more distressed. I think the appointment lasted around 20 minutes. Around 4 weeks later, I got a letter from the DWP saying that I was put into the support group and I would be getting my money backdated. It got backdated around the same time as I got this letter. Although this was a bit of relief, the anxiety and depression still remained. I knew that at some point in the future I would have to go through the same procedure if I was still ill. So I applied for several college courses and managed to get onto one. Thankfully, at the moment, I'm going to college and doing well. I don't have to worry on benefits at the moment, as I've signed off ESA at the end of August 2014 and I'm currently getting a bursary. However, the anxiety and depression is still there and I'm on two different medications to lessen the effects of these conditions. I was first diagnosed with depression when I was 15 and was given Prozac. Ever since, I've been on many medications and seen many psychiatrists, psychologists and CPNs. For some reason, when the medications work, it only lasts for around 6 to 12 months. There are many that doesn't work or the side effects are horrible. My depression can sometimes go away for periods of time, but it always comes back, and when it does, it hits me hard and floors me. I've always had a certain degree of anxiety, but since 2011, it's got worse due to the horrific experiences of Job Seekers Allowance and ESA. Now my anxiety is much worse than my depression, and I'll never forgive the Tories, the DWP, for this. The way I was treated by the DWP is as though I had made up the fact of depression and anxiety, even though I have a 21-year medical reports to prove that I did. It's also like they are trying to say that at the age of 15, I made up the fact I had depression to go and claim benefits at a later stage. Why should people who have medical conditions be put through these experiences? This made my condition much worse, and I'm sure that others are going through the same type of experiences. The stress of applying for ESA and then getting on the awards letter with the ATOS forms is a terrible way to treat somebody when they have more on their plate already. It's like saying, we'll give you the money just now, but here's a reminder, they are going to try and stop you from getting this benefit because we don't believe you're ill. It's even worse when they say that you will be assessed within 3 months and then assess you in 7. This is 7 months of torture worrying about what is going to happen and constantly thinking in my case, obsessing about it. It should only make sense that though my and other medical history notes that these conditions aren't faked to just to claim benefits. Specialists of these conditions are diagnosing me and others with these conditions. Why are they not taken seriously? The information these specialists should be made a priority as they know how an individual functions with their condition. The questions in the ATOS sheets are not suitable and don't give people the chance to go into more detail of their conditions and how it affects them. The questions are too rigid. This makes it harder for the assessor to assess properly and get the whole picture. Common sense should also be used for examining people with long-term medical conditions who are not going to get better and should not have to go through this experience every so often, as they will never recover. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Sean. James, do you want to give us your statement then, please? Thank you.
I've kept mine shorter.
That's all right.
Over the past 3 years, I have applied and been given ESA and ISA, which I supplied evidence for when asked. I was on ISA but was having a lot of problems with my downstairs neighbours. That's how I ended up at Sanet Evergreen. I wasn't coping and I had to go from ISA and apply for ESA. ISA did not sign me off properly and I did not get any money for 4 weeks. After numerous and various phone calls where I got the runaround, I eventually got my money. I was on ESA for about 3 or 4 months and then I got sent to a tribunal which decided I was fit for work. I definitely did not agree with this, but still had to reapply for ISA. Because ESA did not sign me off, I had to go through another 4 weeks of phone calls, etc., before I got my money. I am now on ISA and have been threatened with sanctions from day one, which did not help my mental health. I had to go on a computer course for 9 months to keep the job centre off my back whilst I was ill. This went on for months, but I'm not getting so much bother at the job centre now. The people at the job centre and the people that did my assessment treated me like a number. They were not nice at all. The job centre and benefit systems do not have a clue how to deal with people with mental health problems. As what I went through does not help anybody. I went into a deeper depression because of the way I was treated, and I don't want to go through that again. Doctors aren't sticking by their patients because ATOS put too much pressure on them to sign them off the sick. I came to Sanet Evergreen because of the trouble with my neighbours, loud music, antisocial behaviour, etc. All this caused me to go into a depression. I got no help from the council and had to move. I was attending a cottage, and that's how I heard about Evergreen. Started off as a trainee for 2.5 years, and now I'm being kept as a volunteer. I have suffered with depression from an early age, but didn't know what was wrong with me until I was about 19. I've been in and out of hospital since then. Now I only get medication when I think I need it. Sorry, I was a bit nervous.
No, that's fine. James, you did absolutely fine. What we'll do now is open up to the committee to ask questions and explore some of the points that you made in a bit more depth. This committee has been looking at these types of issues for a period of time, and we've taken evidence from a number of people, including people at the Department of Work and Pensions. Now, one of the senior medical officials from the DWP spoke to us. He said that, or he conceded, that the process itself can actually lead to pressure being brought to bear on people and cause them to fail the assessment, if you like. I don't know if you can fail the assessment, but certainly not to come through it in a particularly good way. Is that your experience? When you were going through this process, did you feel that at the end of it, you were in a worse position than you were at the start in terms of your mental health?
Well, I've had that since I was 19. The forms, I've never been able to fill them in, because I didn't... it's hard to explain how you're feeling. I have good days where I couldn't fill in some of the questions. I thought I would be lying, and yet other days where I should have been filling in the questions. This is how, but that, since Athos took over, I don't even know why you're filling in the form, because a lot of people are just getting...
Yeah, but your experience, did you feel that they listened to you, that the assessor took on board the points that you were making?
Not one.
John, what's your experience?
I kind of felt they were just ticking boxes. That's sort of a den. There was no concern. It was no like going to a psychiatrist or psychologist and they try and talk to you about your condition, any sort of concern at all. It was just tick boxes. It was just done in a very cold, calculated way. And the questions they kind of asked you was, it almost felt like they were asking questions to see if you trip up.
Yeah. Another thing, I don't know if you were able to get an answer. I don't know if you asked the question or whether you had any feeling that the person that was asking you the questions, had they any background in mental health? I mean, were they... The criticism that we've heard is that someone is assessing for someone in terms of their mental health,
Yeah. But
they could be a nurse, physiotherapist even.
The last assessment when I got signed off, it was a nurse that done mines. No mental health nurse, just a nurse.
Yeah. Was that... John,
I'm really unsure. I never asked because at the time I was just so... I was so doped up medication. And I didn't get around to asking. Almost felt like, right, I'm in the room and then start questions. I never get the time almost to ask.
Yeah. When we, was a delegation of committee members went to an ATOS assessment centre to see how they conducted an interview. And it was a scenario that was set up. It was an actress that played the person who was being assessed because we weren't allowed to see someone. Being assessed. It was the way that they train their assessors. The person who was acting, although I have to say she was very good, was acting as someone with a mental health issue.
Right.
The doctor who was asking the questions was aware of that, and he had some specialism in mental health.
Yeah.
The interview took well in excess of half an hour, Kevin, if I remember correctly. It was quite a lengthy process. But John, your experience was that it was over in about 20 minutes.
Yeah, it felt like it was over in 20 minutes. I think roughly, but it wasn't an hour. I wouldn't even... Between 15 minutes to 30 minutes, I'd say it was roughly. As I said at the time, I was on medication. But it definitely wasn't an hour.
But you don't feel as though that you get any understanding of your condition from the period of time that you were there?
No, she was just asking basic questions. She was reading questions out a sheet and ticking boxes. That's what she was doing. It was nae, it wasn't like she was doing it off the top of her head, that sort of thing. You know what I mean? So it was just anybody could do that. I mean, a monkey could, well, not a monkey, but he just sit and say, right, how does this affect you or that affect you? Anybody could do that. And then tick the box. That's
Kevin, I'll come to you now.
Thank you. And John, if I could start off and continue on about the assessment, which seems to be quite short. You said that your mum was there with you in the waiting room. Did she go into the interview?
Yeah, she went to the interview. Yeah.
What did she think of the process?
Did
she keep quiet? Does Nate upset yourself?
When I was getting a wee bit wound up, she would say something, but then she would kind of say, look, it's his interview type thing. So she would basically told to shut up. Well, she didn't get told to shut, you know what I mean? It's just, it's his interview, and that's what it was like.
Right.
She thought it could have been a lot worse. She thought it was going to be a lot worse than that. But I thought it was going to be a lot worse, to be honest with you.
At that interview, when the person was speaking to you, were they looking at you? Were they speaking directly to you? Or were they fiddling with the computer at the same time as they were speaking to you?
It was a bit of both, really. She'd ask a question, and she'd normally, when she's asking questions, look at the computer, and then she'll turn around and look at you for the reply,
And do you think that's a bit off-putting when somebody's speaking to you and kind of turning away? And
yeah, it definitely is, because you just don't know what's on the computer as well. I don't know. No, it was off-putting.
Well, I'll be honest with you, John, when we were at one of those assessments, I was more interested in what was going on at the computer than I was about other things at a certain point. And we actually got to see the computer afterwards, and we probably better not go there
right,
today.
Okay.
So, you've got a situation. Your mum is there, and she's basically not welcome by the sounds of it.
She wasn't welcome. No.
And somebody who's not speaking to you directly, but fiddling at the same time.
Yeah.
So that sets you...
Well, it doesn't feel like they're interested for a start.
Yeah.
As I said, it's just done in a sort of professional, cold way. It's not... It's not proper interaction.
And do you think that... Obviously, you've had a long history of mental health problems. Do you think it's possible for somebody to gather in all of that information in that 20-minute period?
Definitely not. Because they never went into too much detail in that. They just asked it's basically how you feel right now, and that's it. It's not today. They don't get too much into your background or what happened in the past. It's how you feel right at this moment.
And your own doctor, did they ask your own doctor about the experiences that you've gone through and what they thought about your condition and whether or not you were fit for work?
Sorry, did the assessor ask my doctor?
Yes.
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay, that's very useful. James, I wonder if I could ask you, similar in terms of the assessments and the tribunals that you've gone through, did you feel that they were paying due care and attention to your condition?
Well, my wife was with me and she wasn't allowed in.
She wasn't allowed in?
I was 10 minutes and I was out the door. I don't know how she could assess me in 10 minutes.
Did they give you a reason why your wife couldn't go in?
No. Because way back when I was actually on it, when I was under a doctor that I was under for years, I had 23 points and I was on the cusp of things. She wasn't allowed in then. And the doctor was a bit more, but I mean, he gave me a thorough examination. This was about 8 years ago. A thorough medical examination, physical examination, and spoke about this, that and another. Well, since then, I went from 23 points to my last assessment to 9 points, and the DWP even wrote the 9 points off.
Okay. But no reason was given for why your wife couldn't go in, why you weren't allowed support at that?
No.
Okay, I think that's probably one of the first times that we've heard something like that, and I think we probably need to follow up on that. If I could turn back to you again, John, obviously you had an experience in Aberdeen, and I'm from Aberdeen, and I'm sorry you had that experience there, I have to say. By the sounds of it, you've got a support network at home in Motherwell, your mum and others. Do you think it's wise for the DWP and others to force folk into work away from home where they lose their support network?
No, definitely not. That's what was most... I was a big worry to me as well, but I felt I had no choice. I felt I had to do it at the time. I felt I was forced into doing it.
So being forced into doing that, did that create a real major setback in terms of your health after going up there for that short period?
That finished me off, kind of, at the time. That after that, I was just down there. After, I was just really, really down, depressed, anxious. That was the final straw. That's when within a week or two, that's when I went and got a sick note from the doctor and went on ESA. That really pushed me over the edge at that point. I mean, because it was the fact that I had to go up there away from my family. And then you're in there, and then all the stuff that they told me at the interview, this is what's going to happen. When they told me I had the job, they said it'll be like this, it'll be like that. The accommodation's great. It was an absolute disgrace. And then when you go there and you see all that, and you hear all the stories from other people, it was just, it really, I couldn't have stayed in the house any longer. I had to get away the next day. I had to just go home. It really pushed me over the edge. And all I did after that was just, I was just so anxious. I just kept thinking about getting sanctioned and things like that all the time. I'd like to eventually get a job, right? But I want to get a job that's not going to make me ill. I really do want to work. That's why I'm at college, which I'm quite enjoying at the moment. But I want to find something that doesn't make me ill. It's just something that helps me. Because there is work out there that can help people. You want to have a purpose in life. You don't want to just sit about the house all the time. And if you want to go out and do something, you just don't want... To me, anyway, I don't want to have to rely on benefits. I want to go out and do my thing. I want to go out and work and have a purpose in my life.
But you've got to find something that's right for you. An employer that understands some of the difficulties that you may face from time to time.
Yeah. I mean, there's certain types of work I've done in the past that's made me ill. There's certain types of work, it's benefited me. So I kind of have got a rough idea of what works and what doesn't.
Obviously, both of you have had quite a lot of help from Sam H. As well. How would you have coped, James, do you think, if Sam H. hadn't been there to help you and your family along the way?
Well, what I was going through with the council, my neighbours, the police and whatnot, if I hadn't now been at the cottage, me and my wife would have probably been on the streets because we couldn't have taken any more from the neighbours. And it's through the cottage that I learnt about Sam H. And if it wasn't for Sam H, I wouldn't be able to sit here and talk now, because 2.5 years ago I was a mess. I'd actually attempted suicide because I was getting nowhere. I just was going round in circles. I was having my wife was going through all that. I was fighting the neighbours, I was fighting the council. But as I say, if it wasn't for day two, I would have probably done myself in. I attempted an overdose, but I must have no meant to harm, luckily. I wouldn't think like that now. I still feel suicidal quite often, but I'm glad I didn't go, because I've got a lot of loving to do yet, hopefully.
Hopefully that'll be the case, James. John, do you think, how has Sam H helped you as well?
Yeah, well, it did help me. They knew what I was going through. It wasn't like just going and seeing a psychologist that have learned stuff at a university and things like that. They've got experience in mental health, your peer support especially, and I felt it helped me. It helped me find what I wanted to do. They helped me find a college course and told me how to go about getting a college course and things like that. So yeah, it was very helpful. They gave me some sort of, when I had nothing in my life, I felt I had nothing in my life, they kind of helped point in the direction a wee bit, like, you could do this. So, yeah, it was very helpful.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Thank you, convener.
Good morning. Can I say thank you very much for your evidence this morning? I'm very new to the committee, only joined last week, but your evidence today is going to help inform us so much. And I really appreciate you both coming along today. I was interested in a couple of things that you both said. John, you had said that they're only interested in how you feel right now. In terms of the interview. And James, you also, when you were talking about filling in the forums, you were mentioning that on some days you were able to engage in that process of doing it, but only on a better day for you. So given that you both said those two things, does any of your experience in the whole process, do you feel you've been given an opportunity to explain the varying nature of your condition and how it affects you in the whole, or has it always been just this, you know, you're in a room for 15 minutes or half an hour or whatever, and they make a decision on how you behave in that time, and none of that previous information is taken into account?
Yeah, that's exactly what happened. They were just interested in how you felt there on the day. They weren't interested really much. I mean, they may be interested in what happened the past 3 months or so, but they don't really go beyond. They don't really go into too much information. Well, they don't ask for too much information about when it all started, the actual when I started suffering for depression and things like that, and how it varies, and how I can go up and I can go down. And they don't really go into that. It's just, it's really here, there, now type boxes.
My medical file for mental health from a doctor, I got out recently. It's like that. I never got one question about anything that was on it with the assessor. But my kind of depression, I mean, at this time of year I suffer from OCD because of cold, things like that as well. I've got that kind of problem. I mean, I could go years without feeling I could be okay. But what happened with the neighbours and that, I just felt I was fighting the world. My doctor put me on, I was actually assaulted by one of them. He got charged, he got up lightly. The charge went for something that got dropped up, went on for 12 months. I was fighting that as well. But to try and express that to your doctor, DWP, things like that, you didn't get a chance to tell them anything like that. I mean, I went into the DWT, my black eye, and the person that signed me on asked what happened to me. A quick question, I said, I got assaulted. I wouldn't like to see him then. I said, I never had him once.
And in terms of the process, I think, John, in your evidence, you say quite clearly that the whole process and the delays in the process had made your anxiety levels far, far worse.
Yeah.
Is there anything that would have made that easier for you? Is there anything in the system that you think would have prevented that happening for you?
Well, I think if they maybe used a wee bit of common sense, they'd go to my doctors and psychiatrists, CPNs and that I've seen at the time, and ask them, they're specialists. They know me, they've got the records there. They didn't have to send me a letter for saying I get an ESA and there's the ATOS. No, they just didn't have to do that. I mean, it's like, originally when I was on ESA, I thought I was only going to be on it for about 6 weeks to 3 months. I thought I was just going to get my head together and then start looking again. But then you get that, and then it just adds on to it. And then before you know it, you're worrying about that, and then you're worrying about all the other stuff. And it just doesn't help. It doesn't help at all. It makes it much worse. Much, much worse. Your condition gets worse when you get that. And then you've got the stress of filling out the forms and all the questions that are in the forms. And it's not necessarily they're difficult. They are difficult questions to ask in the sense that they're difficult to look and read, and then you've got to think about, or like so suicidal thoughts and things like that. But they're not difficult to answer writing down words, but I mean, it's just, you have to think a lot, and then when you're thinking about all these different questions and the aspects, that you start to go, before you know it, when you're finished it, you feel absolutely terrible. You feel really, really, really
stressed.
Yeah.
Thank you both.
Ken.
Thanks. Thank you both for coming along and telling us about your experience. Can I just ask you, John, first? It sounds like you wanted to, you tried to stay on GSA as long as possible. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, I did.
Is that because you felt GSA was, I don't know, less stressful, more supportive than ESA? Were you worried about ESA?
I felt that I wanted to get work. I wanted to find a job. I was on benefits years ago. It was different types of, I think it was like severe disablement allowance, this was quite a while ago, and income support. And I felt a bit trapped. when I was on it, because it's just, you just became dependent on it. Whereas I felt with GSA, I was looking for work, and I didn't think I was going to be on GSA for long. I thought when I moved down from the Highlands and I came here, to Motherwell, I thought I was going to find a job within a month or something.
Yeah.
And before I knew it, I was on it for 2 years.
Yeah.
And it just had its impact on me, really. That's why I didn't want to get back onto benefits. It's like sickness benefits, that thing.
Right. And then I can see, obviously, the experience in Aberdeen was a bad one.
Yeah.
Was it the doctor who suggested you go into ESA, or the doctor signed you off? But what was the process of just transferring from GSA to ESA? Was it your decision? Was it your advisor? Did somebody advise you? Was it the...
It was my doctor, because I went and seen the doctor before I went to Aberdeen, and they advised me to go in the sick, but I was just too scared to do it, so I ended up, I just went to Aberdeen. Yeah. Then I came back, seen Renpoy, and they advised me to go in ESA for like 6 weeks or something, just to get my head together.
Yeah.
And then that's what happened. I went to the doctor and I got an ESA, and before I know it, I was on for about a year. So.
Right, but the people in GSA, did you tell them that you were having mental health difficulties or depression?
They knew all about it. Well, when I applied for GSA, I mean, you go in first and they just ask you basic questions, and I told them about the medication I was on. I told them about my medical conditions, so they knew all about it.
But both you and they were saying, but you wanted to get a job, so you'd rather be in GSA than ESA at that point, anyway.
At the time, because as I said at the time, I just thought GSA, that'll cover me till I get a job, which I thought was going to be quite soon.
And then when you're on ESA, what happened there was that you applied for it. Now, you actually got the benefit. Am I right in thinking this? You got the benefit. You took a while to fill in the form, but you were getting the
yeah, you get £70 a week or something.
But then, so then your mum filled in the form. The benefits weren't stopped, though, were you? I mean, it took you 7 months.
No, it didn't stop.
You did, right, okay. So, cause I'm intrigued because clearly you didn't have a particularly supportive experience. At the same time, I'm not sure you'd show up in any of this official statistics because you went from GSA to SA, you received both. Although the process might have been stressful, you actually came through it and you were approved, you know what I mean?
Yeah, eventually, I was approved and I came through it,
And it sounds also, I mean, I could be wrong with this, but it sounds as if the interview that you had for ESA was aimed at assessing your mental health. I mean, it wasn't, we've had difficulties in the past because the whole system's designed around physical disability rather than poor mental health. But in your case, it did sound like they were trying to explore, perhaps not very sensitively, but they were trying to explore... how unwell or well you were?
Yeah, there was nothing physical, not really. It was all about the mental health.
Right. And can I just ask James as well yourself? Now, you had the transfer from GSA to ESA. Was it your choice or theirs? I mean, you've had a few delays, but I was trying to work out, just trying to track the system as it were. Was it they suggested you apply for ESA, or was it you suggested it, or was it the CAB, or who was it? Suggested?
Well, I had to go on ESA because I wasn't coping. I was putting that much tablets. When I was at the cottage speaking to the woman there, she was saying things and she was trying to get eye contact with me.
Yeah.
I was there physically, but I wasn't there mentally because I was so doped up. That's what I found out. Hard.
And was it it was Sam H possibly that recommended that you apply for the ESA support?
No, I mean, the doctor put me on the sick.
The doctor, right, okay.
And I was on it for a while, and because of all the changes and that, I was in such a mess that he gave me a 3 month line, and automatically when you get that, they send you the forms for ESA.
Right.
And I filled them on, and I was fine. But I'm still getting flashbacks for that assault two and a half years ago. I get good days and bad days. I've been really nervous coming here.
I know. Well, you're doing fine, so don't worry about that part. So.
No.
Can I just check? Because both of you have mentioned this about being feeling threatened by the possibility of sanctions or losing your benefit. Have you ever been sanctioned in the last few months or years?
Well, when I was on ESA, as you can put a read it to you, I actually asked to get my tablets cut down because I wasn't. I was going about it, honest, I was like a zombie. When I got the tablets cut down, I was beginning to feel better, but the doctor didn't seem to understand that I was still going through all this in my head. When I was the ESA thing with for so long, and my doctor was putting the pressure to not give me a sick line again. And I stayed on, but I'm still with this and that. And I got sent for the assessment. And the nurse that assessed me took me for too many points down to, as I say, 9. And because of that, I got sent to a tribunal. And I had to fill in all the forms, like John says. And I filled in the forms. I said, but I didn't feel like that today. And I didn't want to fill that one. And so really, when I filled in all the boxes, I was filling that form out on quite a good day. So I didn't write hardly anything. So I could understand them saying maybe going for 23 points to 9. If they'd got me 2.5 years ago, they would have went, oh, you better go into the hospital, pal. I was in that much a mess. I would have probably been away up there. You agree with me? That's how mental health. I mean, because of my circumstances, I mean, I'd actually shut down. If I could, it's hard to try and, I'm trying to explain to make it simple for you.
Well, could I also ask John as well, because you were obviously very worried about sanctions. You felt like, you said several times, you know, you felt you were being interrogated or judged or whatever else, and you felt very particularly anxious about the threat of sanctions. In the end, you weren't. Were you sanctioned? You weren't sanctioned.
No, I wasn't sanctioned.
Yes, but it's the. Was it? I'm trying to work out. I mean, do you think the process? I'm trying to work out what we could do with the process to make it less intimidatory or less judgmental. I mean, do you think there are obvious things that could be done? You know, if you have to go along and you have to sign on and you have to demonstrate, you know, the state of your health, physical or mental. Is there any way, you know, is it the stories you're hearing about the sanctions process that is making you fearful, or is it the attitude of the people across the desk, a mixture of the form, the complications of the form, your own anxiety? I'm trying to work out which.
It was both. It was the way I was getting questioned by the clerks, whatever you want to call them, behind the desk. There was one time I went in, and she looked at it and she says, you've not wrote the websites that you've been looking for, the jobs you've been looking for. And I says, I have. And then she looked at it and says, oh, sorry. It's just like they're always trying to trip you up. And then you did hear about all this stuff. And I'm quite aware of what's happening, the changes. So, yeah, it was a bit of both. As for how things could be better, well, I start helping people look for work instead of throwing them out to VDAB job clubs. To be honest with you, and just start helping folk looking for work. It's just like you're getting in there and it's like it's just a gloomy, horrible sort of atmosphere, really. It's just it's horrible.
Try and help us.
I think what's interesting, particularly in your case, John, is that when you had an element of choice, it made things, you know, I mean, Remploy didn't work for you, which is interesting, and another couple of other experiences you had didn't work. But the sort of peer support you eventually had through Sam H, which seems to have been something that you opted for rather than something that was thrust upon you, has been more beneficial and more constructive.
What was suggested, I went for them, and yeah, it has been beneficial, definitely. I feel, as I said, they sort of helped. When I was just, I couldn't think of anything else. I was just down there. I didn't want to do anything. They were aching. I said, well, you could go to college. So, yeah, they definitely helped.
And I take it, can you see a sort of a path out, particularly out of college, you know, with qualifications or training now that...
Yeah, possibly.
We'll see, It's difficult when you've had a bad experience already.
Sorry?
It's difficult when you've had a bad experience already to see what's going to happen next.
Well, I'm just taking that a year at a time at the moment. I'd like to go to college for a wee while, a couple of years, and then see what happens.
Okay. Thanks very much.
No problem.
Okay, Christine.
Thanks very much, John and James, for your evidence this morning. And I want to maybe carry on a wee bit from where Michael started and where Ken finished, really. When you went in for the interviews and any of the assessments, were you given any advice at all that you were allowed to take a support worker with you or somebody to help you? So you weren't informed that was a potential option?
No. I think it tells you in a letter, if you think you feel you need somebody with you, but they didn't get to a doctor or this or that.
Right, but when you took somebody like your wife, then they didn't let her in?
If I had a bad day and I was having a bad day, because I always get stressed when I go to them, I like my wife there. But what I'd went through, I had to get a taxi up because I wasn't able to travel on buses in case I bumped into the guy that assaulted me. So, I mean, they didn't give you any idea or even ask you things like that.
Mm-hmm. They even say to you when you get into the room, have you got a support worker coming or do you want somebody to be with you?
Well, my wife was there and she didn't even ask if my wife, would you like your wife to come or anything? She just says, any come.
Okay, was that the same experience for
you,
John?
I just brought on my mum. I didn't know if she'd get in the room or not, but she got in the room.
But they didn't say to you, maybe you would like to bring a support worker or somebody to support you?
No, not that I recall, no.
Okay, would that have helped?
I never even contacted my doctor the last time.
Right.
So, what was the point? They didn't have any of my medical records. Mm-hmm. They're only assessing me how they see me today. Know what happened the first time I was 19 and what's mm-hmm. happened. I mean, if they had my medical records in front of them, then they could ask me some questions like you're doing today.
Would it have helped to have the support worker for Sam H with you?
Well, at that time, I was dealing with that much things. I just wanted to get her and done me. But it would have probably helped if I had somebody for some of it. I mean, because if I have any problems, when I'm on a real downer, our instructor, he could actually sense that when I'm in, and he'll ask if I'm okay, but if the place is busy, there's need to talk, but he'll try and find a time where he'll get, and he'll ask what's wrong with you today, because he sees all that. I mean, the person at a session, you know they're 24/7. You're not getting tucked up in bed aside them, so they're not seeing you when you're having a good day or a bad day, you understand?
Yeah. So it would probably help if they had taken into account all of the past history and...
I've never had any help for it. I went to the Citizen Advice Bureau once when I went to a tribunal, and sorry to say, but I would have been probably better speaking for myself because she didn't do a very good job. So that kind of put me off trying to get somebody to back me up. But if I was ever to go to that again, I would definitely have Sam Hicks behind me. Like my instructor, if he was quite willing to come with me. Because he could tell, I mean, the last 2.5 years, he's seen the wreck I was to what I am now.
Yeah.
I mean, I couldn't have came in this room 2.5 years ago, never mind speak to you.
You're doing fine. John, was that maybe something that would have helped you to have...
Yeah, probably.
You know, a recognised support worker there, somebody that you knew, you and...
Yeah, uh-huh. I probably would have, because they've seen me days when I'm not too good and things like that as well. I mean, they've seen me previously, so yeah, it probably would have been helpful.
Do you think part of the assessment process should be that if you have got a support agency like that or a support worker or, you know, somebody that knows you really well, for them to give some sort of a testimony or understanding of how they think you cope when you go to the assessment, do you think that would inform the process better?
Well, it could, but I still think common sense should be used. I still believe that they should be looking at the specialists that know you, that have seen you in the past and look at records and things like that. I think that should be taken into account more.
Yeah. I know that none of you had said you had any sanctions, but have any of you experienced appeals? John, James, have you experienced having to go through an appeal? You said about a tribunal earlier.
No, but when I first came back off ESA and I'm having the problem getting back onto ESA, all the things were happening and the DWP. The first day I went with my wife because I didn't feel comfortable going back in to sign on, and she actually saw us two together. And I wasn't 10 minutes sat down and she was threatening me with sanctions. I said, what you got sanctioned me for? You're not doing enough job searches. I said, I'm only just starting. I said, I can't work a computer. That's how it ended up there. I had to go on a computer course for 9 months. You know, I got that for 9 months. But seemingly, I don't know what's happened. Westminster took the pressure off or what. The ATOS Atos was, I don't know if I can say it, they were like the Gestapo.
Okay. John, appeals, did you have to go through any appeals?
No.
See, when you did have fluctuations with your income, whether it was coming off your JSA and on ESA and any of the other, you said the STA, which is an old severe disablement allowance, were you signposted to any other benefits that you were entitled to? You know, was there a huge impact on your you know, your earnings, your ability, you know, to heat your house and put food in the fridge and stuff?
No, definitely. I've got affected by the bedroom tax as well, two bedrooms. And I had to pay everything. It was something like £8 a week off that, so that was £16 off the £140, which take £124. The heating, the electricity bills rising and things like that, yeah, it definitely did too.
And they didn't, when you were explaining some of that, signpost you to other entitlement you've got with the local authority as far as mitigation? Or?
Never get told anything.
No, nothing at all.
No.
And if you're in a state of high anxiety and you may be worrying about paying your bills, or how did that affect you? Did that?
Well, I was kind of, I mean, my mum and that kind of helped me quite a bit with that. I can't really remember that much at the time, because when I was anxious, you're just thinking constantly, you're just worrying all the time. And then I was getting the medication which I was on, and that just doped me right up. So a lot of the time was quite bloody. You know what I mean? I just wasn't functioning properly at all.
Yeah.
So it kind of affected. I was paying bills and things like that.
Yeah. What about you, James? Was that similar
pressures? Well, when I was on JSA and I suddenly decided I was fit for work, JSA hadn't signed me off.
So you were left for a period, was it 4 weeks without anything?
Well, I got the sick line, and JSA hadn't signed me off in Kirkcaldy, and I had to go through phone calls. My first one cost me £8, I got nowhere. And thanks to the cottage, I was able to go in there and make the phone calls. But this went on for 4 weeks, and I eventually found out through one woman that I eventually got that the job centre in Kirkcaldy hadn't assigned me up to ISA, and this is why I didn't get any money for 4 weeks. And I went through the same when I went back from that to that, and I had no money for 4 weeks. All right, I got back there, but how was I supposed to live for 4 weeks? I had to borrow a friend's family. Just not everybody's got that support like we've got.
No, and if you've got a mental health issue, then having to go and ask for that.
So that made you even more stressed. Yeah. I mean, that really put me on a downer. I mean, I can't imagine what that'd be like for somebody with kids. I mean, I've got kids, but I mean, they're all up now, thank God. But my wife, a diabetic, and if it hadn't been for that, I actually got a loan, which was about 2 weeks into the waiting for, and I only got that because one person actually had the sense to ask if my wife had any conditions. They weren't bothered about my mental conditions, but when I said diabetic, oh, you'll get the loan. Aye.
Okay, and that was a loan for the DWP?
Aye,
which
had to
be paid back off your benefits.
If they'd given me my money, I wouldn't have to go through all that rigmarole.
Indeed. One of the things that we hear a lot, I mean, I'm quite new to this committee as well, but obviously it's something that all of us have taken a big interest in, is all of these issues. See that issue about you not being signed off one benefit, therefore it impacted another. Was that an experience that you had? Because some people I know, that there was a phone in this morning on the radio actually, and somebody phoned in and says they'd lost their forms and their records 4 times. Is that something that you've experienced a lot?
Well, I'm surprised they didn't say the computer was doing, because before we had computers, that's what they used to say, we've lost your form. Now you're usually like, oh, but the computer's been doing them, we're having this, that, and that. Right. I don't think they have. What there was, there's been so much pressure on everything changing over in the DWP, and one department doesn't know what the other department is doing until they've got that sorted out. That's why I think when I went, I mean, somebody in Glasgow I'm speaking to, they're bringing it up on the computer. They didn't care that I didn't tell them that JSA hadn't timed me off. It was actually one woman, after about 3 weeks on, she actually come up on the computer. The reason you're not getting your money is the job centre hasn't pressed the button.
Okay. Is that something you experienced, John?
No.
Not really?
No, not really, no.
No. Sorry, can we just mark the very final question was around about, you know, you've given us a lot of really, you know, detailed personal feelings this morning and how that's had an impact on you. Do you think one way to solve some of these problems would be to have one key identified person that would be your person as your DWP to speak to you about everything rather than all that phone calls all over the place? Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you very much. And can I also say thanks very much for coming in today, because it's so important for us to hear people speaking directly about their experiences rather than through a third person. So thanks very much. I wanted to ask you, I mean, I'm not an expert in mental health, but my understanding of it is that self-esteem is really important, and it's a trigger. If your self-esteem is damaged, that's a trigger for anxiety and depression. And listening to your testimonies today and reading through them, I'm struck by, you know, phrases like, I was treated like a number, or I was talked to very disrespectfully. That must have an effect on your self-esteem, does it?
It does.
Yeah. Yeah, and do you find there can be an immediate relationship between, you know, feeling your self-esteem damaged and getting ill, or is it a cumulative thing?
Well, I mean, it builds up. I mean, if you've got depression or anxiety or whatever, and somebody's talked to you like a piece of dirt, I mean, you're going to take it personal, and then you're going to think about it, and then you obsess about it, and then before you know it, within a day or two, you're a complete nut job. I don't mean you just don't function right. You just end up obsessing about it, and then you get really, really ill. That's what I get. That's what I'm like anyway.
And you think, on balance, the people that you encounter, not just in terms of the main assessments, but the people that you encounter in the system, on balance, how do you think that they treat you? Do the majority of them treat you with respect, or are you mainly treated with disrespect?
I'd say bulkly with disrespect, but there is a few people that are quite nice to you, and quite sympathetic. But yeah, I'd say the bulk of people, it's just this professional cold attitude you get from them.
So actually being in the system is damaging to you?
It definitely is. Most definitely. It makes you worse. Makes you worse.
Is that your experience as well, James?
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't know what's going on in my head. Unless you suffered a mental health problem yourself. And it's not easy to put in words, but I found whoever you were speaking to, there's still the stigma there. A lot of people, I say, I've got mental health problems. Well, they think you're a nutter. I've only had one or two, and on the phone, I've got one really nice person and one person in the job centre that treated me like a person. And if somebody treats you nice, you'll talk back to them nice. I mean, if you bounce out at me, I'll bounce out at you back. But that's the sort of attitude you got in the job centre. I mean, that female that threatened to sanction me, she made sure everybody heard her. And my wife grabbed my hand. I said, well, sanction me. That was my first thing, mate.
And that would make you feel humiliated, would it? Yeah.
Oh, well, I mean, imagine you somebody shouting, you know, if I was to shout at you, I'm going to sanction you. How would you react?
Yeah.
I just said, well, sanction me then. She changed the subject and then calmed down. She must have thought she was speaking to a 15, 16-year-old that they're having problems with. I mean, I'm 59.
How, in terms of the people right across the system, as I say, not just people that are doing your main assessment, do you think that they would benefit from more training and more awareness of mental health issue and how their behaviour can affect people's mental health?
Yeah, it probably could, yeah.
And I also wanted to speak to you about the effect of work. You talked about your security course, which your security job, which sounds horrific, and you mentioned the course in computers. In terms of anxiety can go with depression, but anxiety can also trigger depression. And I suppose any change for any of us brings on anxiety. Like a new job is quite an anxious time for everyone, but if you have a mental health problem, it must be particularly anxious, is it? And do you think you get any support or any recognition that the actual act of moving into to work is a a stressful, intense time that could affect your health.
But from the DWP?
Yeah.
No, not at all. They don't care, it's just a number.
Yeah.
Get them into work.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
And what kind, obviously you're both different, but John, what kind of work do you think is particularly damaging to your condition, your medical condition?
Something that's really, really monotonous. It just, where you have to think, I like to keep busy and do different things.
Mm-hmm.
If you're doing something monotonous or something boring, you start to think, you start to get anxious, you start, the depression creeps in, and that really is a damaging impact on my health.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's a security job, I mean, you're standing about, and what you do when you're standing about, you start to think too much, and you get anxious, and then the anxious goes to depression, and
mm-hmm.
If I went up there and even tried to stick that, I would have lasted a week or something.
Mm-hmm.
To be honest with you.
Well, you're kept busy. You're like me that way. If you're kept busy rather than being a really boring job, your mind's now gone back to how you're feeling.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, totally.
And have you had experience of work that has been good for you, that you felt that was been good for your mental health?
But most of this that I've experienced with work-wise is really the voluntary jobs that I've done.
Yeah.
I done a furniture moving job, but I mean, it wasn't the most exciting job in the world, but it was just like you were going around houses taking furniture. It was really a charity. It was like taking furniture and giving it to people on benefits and things like that, or you'd take donations, and yeah, something like that was okay. I mean, it wasn't the most stimulating job, but it was, I think it was partly because you were driving about different places and.
Yeah. Well, they do say that sort of helping other people is one of the best things in terms of feel good, isn't it? It
makes you
feel
better if you're helping
someone.
Yeah.
Was that your experience of volunteering as well?
Yeah, well, so much has helped me because, as I say, I was a wreck at the time. And when I first went to so much, I kept myself by myself. And gradually, I mean, I've always been an outdoor person, so much was good for me. But I've done a lot of jobs. But I've got a bad back now, and I got a lot of problems. It's on the computer that I can't do any heavy lifting. And the first thing they're trying to send me for is landscape message, I can't do that anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm 59, that's not old. I said, you can try and lift a 3x2 slab with a bad back and mental health problems. So how do they help me? I mean, they're not even looking at your file.
Mm-hmm.
They're just going, what have you done today?
Did you get the impression from them they had quotas then, that they didn't really care, that they just had quotas?
I just feel what the DWP has done in the last 2 years, they've got a script. Because I actually know, over the last 9 months, I know their script. I know, I get shipped for this one and this one, I'm going, it's just like what John's saying, they're trying to trip you up.
Yeah.
I mean, when you've got mental health problems, unless you've written it down, you can't remember what maybe she asked you last week. But I've got wise to that. I've started writing things down. And since I've done the computer, of course, I'm keeping that logged as well. Trying to fight back.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Just one final question from me. Same mostly you, John, but James, if you can answer this as well, please feel free. You've said in your statement you were concerned about the ATOS forum that you got. It didn't allow you enough information or enough space to give the information you would have wanted to do. Now, that's a common complaint that we had, that there was such a basic forum. How could anyone properly assess your condition on the basis of what you're allowed to answer?
Yeah.
We've also established that the DWP are supposed to make that assessment not just on the basis of the ATOS forum that's returned, but also from what's called further medical evidence from the GP.
Yeah.
The vast majority of appeals that are successful have been proven to be because information which was not provided at the outset later becomes available, and it actually helps that person then to win the appeal.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you said in your statement that you didn't believe that information was taken seriously. That the people that know you best,
mm-hmm.
the people who have assessed you and have your consultant or whoever you've spoken to, and that their information should be given a priority. Are you aware of whether your GP provided that further medical evidence? in your case, have you spoken to your GP? Did they receive a request from ATOS to get that information?
I'm unsure. I really don't know. I really don't know.
Yeah. I'm just wondering. Because, yeah.
The first one, the GP, they wrote to my GP, and my GP said on the form that I hadn't seen me for 2 years. Well, I hadn't seen me for 2 years because I got fed up going back to him and getting things with the tablets, this, that, and that. And the last time the thing with, I didn't even contact my doctor because I never got it back.
Right, so you know that your GP was not contacted?
My GP wouldn't have backed me up anyway. I mean, that's what I'm trying to explain. Since I was 19, I've only had two doctors when I was younger. And the doctor, when I started stuff, he should have been a psychiatrist, never mind a GP. He actually fought my psychiatrist. But the doctor I've got now, I don't know him, I can't speak to him. He's got my medical record, and I bet he's never even read it.
Yeah. Now, the information we have is that over half of GPs are not returning the forms, are not returning the information that's sought by the DWP. The fact that you didn't have to go to an appeal means that they must have taken the information from you on the forum plus your interview and made their assessment on the basis of that. Mm-hmm. That's an assumption.
Yeah.
But if you don't know that the GP provided additional information, we can't know whether it was taken into account or not. So I'm just checking to see whether that was the case or not.
Well, when I went to the appeal, it does say on the form, any further information. Well, when I got my medical records, I took it certain recent things. Oh, you've got, why did you not hand that in? I was told to go to the room for 10 minutes and they read what I gave them and come back. We can't find any reason why we should still know, because I got the thing that I had to sign, they signed me off saying I was fit.
Right. Okay. Is there anything else that John and James, you want to tell us? Was there something when you were coming through this morning thinking, I really need to let these guys know what I feel about something? This is your chance to tell us what you want to explain things to you.
I think it's been noticed recently as well that GPs, there's not enough of them. My GP is only one doctor. Trying to get an appointment now is about a week. I'm really nervous today because I've run out of my medication. I've only had a few minutes. My medication has been cut. I've not got a chance to get back to get my medication. I've been trying to get through to him and can't get through to him. Eventually, an emergency appointment. I've never had that experience with a doctor. My wife's got three doctors. Well, that's what I was in when I was younger. But the GP I'm under now, and she's trying to get onto another GP's list. I keep it, it's only for a marriage. You've got a doctor. So I can't even change them.
John, is there anything you wanted to say?
No, I'm
happy with your statement. Okay. Can I thank you both very much for coming through this morning? I know it might have been difficult at times for you to answer some of the questions, but I really do appreciate the openness that you engaged with us. I think we've all learned a lot this morning from you. It's been really beneficial from the committee's point of view to hear your testimonies to us and your experiences of the system. We'll use that to build on the information which we've already picked up. We're going to continue taking these issues forward and challenging the system because the experience that you've had is all too common and not acceptable to this committee. So thanks very much for giving us more information, which helps us to take forward this issue on your behalf. But thanks to you and to Sam H for providing the support and assistance to making this your say session this morning. Thank you. Okay, with that, I'll suspend the meeting for the moment.